Hello everyone, and very pleased to welcome you for our last part of Luma Live series. I'm Alex from Luma, and we are talking about today another look at the COVID-19 epidemic in Thailand. And the part three, it's about the COVID-19 vaccine. What are the trends? So for that, I'm happy to welcome you again, Doctor. So this will be the last part and the final part of our Luma Live series. Maybe in the future we'll do some, but for the moment it's the last one. Thank you very much, Doctor.
You're welcome. You're welcome, Alex. Always a pleasure to be here.
Thank you very much. So for this session, we will talk about mostly some questions. So we will start the Facebook Live with a simple question. Could you explain us what are the vaccine trends, please?
Okay. So I think the topic is very wide, very big. A bit like the first topic we had about early treatment. There are a lot of controversies. So not everybody agrees on what are the trends, whether the vaccine should be used or not. I'm trying to just look at the facts. And of course, it's also a bit of my personal opinion. But everybody is free to look at their own source of information and get their own beliefs about the vaccine. Especially during this time. So the vaccine trends, as you may know, in Thailand, we had a very low number of deaths last year. It's good. We had 61 people who died as of end of December. By comparison with France, which is a country we know very well, of course, is 1,000 less, 1,000 times less. France, which is above 60,000 people during 2020. So Thailand's 61. So obviously the motivation to start the campaign was much stronger in France than in Thailand. So that can explain why Thailand had a very slow start, which is in a way coherent. But now the Thai government has really put the turbo, as we say in France. They have really accelerated. From the early February 2021, there were a few thousand people vaccinated. At the beginning, and now we can see close to 1 million people being vaccinated in one day. So throughout the country, they are doing very fast vaccination campaign, and the government expect and hope to have about 70% of the population being fully vaccinated by the end of the year.
Hopefully.
Hopefully, which is very important because, as you know, this also will be a very important contributing factor to reopening the country, especially to tourism. And if this can happen before, let's say, December or November, that will be some kind of oxygen, pure oxygen for the hotel business, which has been suffering
tourism
so much.
Especially, yes.
So let's see what happened. Last point on this, about a bit more than 1 million people already got a third dose. Especially those who received early the Sinovac, twice injection of Sinovac. There were a significant number of people, especially in the medical field, who contracted COVID despite being vaccinated. And so that encouraged people to make a boost of their immunity with additional vaccine, which we call the third vaccine. And about 500,000 got that.
Okay.
By the way, did you get vaccinated?
Yes, I did already.
You can stay together. Okay.
Yeah, we can stay together, yes. Okay, good. So this is good because you talk about the third dose of vaccine. Maybe we will go to this subject later on.
Yeah.
But for the moment, I will continue with my questions. So where are we regarding the COVID-19 vaccine process? You talk about the system, the turbo Thailand put. So can you explain us, like, where are we now?
But initially, I think the government has the usual coherent approach, which is to vaccinate first the most vulnerable people, which are also those who are also the highest risk of being contaminated, especially the medical staff, the doctors, nurses, etc. The civil servant exposed to the public, like policemen, army personnel, and also those who are at higher risk to develop more severe form of COVID. So can be sometimes relatively middle-aged people, but they have, let's say, a very severe comorbidity, such as obesity, severe obesity, hypertension, immunodepression. So these people will be vaccinated as a priority. I think the Thailand did a very nice vaccine process. What they do now is they look also at the color of the different province. The green, yellow, red, and dark red.
Yes.
So the dark red is where the virus circulated very quickly, where a lot of people have been hospitalized. So
in Bangkok, for example,
Bangkok is one of them. It's still a dark red zone.
Mm-hmm.
And so the government has put more priority to vaccinate these people because of the spread of the virus.
Okay.
So regarding the children, now I can see a last point here. There is a plan to vaccinate children from 12 years and older,
mm-hmm.
To facilitate the reopening of the school. And hopefully, it'll be one of the best news for the kids to finally see each other and play together.
Play together, yes.
Yeah, instead of just being behind the computer. Yeah.
Yes. Okay, thank you for this clarifying information. My next question will be, what are the prime and boost vaccines? You talk about the third one, maybe we'll talk after this one, but what is the prime and what is the boost? Can you please explain us?
Okay, this is something which is now in the, let's say, general public conversation.
Yes.
And okay, I'll try to explain. Prime means is the first injection which a person receive,
mm-hmm.
and boost will be the second injection. We didn't so much use this before because we didn't have what is happening now, which is a different type of vaccination which start with one type of vaccine followed by another type of vaccine.
Mm-hmm.
I come back to that. Yeah. So typically the prime is to have the initial stimulation,
okay.
of the immune system, which lead to an increase in antibodies, but relatively low, still mm-hmm. low, and a minimal immune memory ability from some specific white blood cell. So it's important to have the prime, but the prime does not protect really, just like an initial stimulation of the immune system. The boost, which we see in many, many other types of vaccinations,
mm-hmm.
Is a second injection, which is usually given next 3 to 6 weeks after the first prime shot.
Okay.
So the boost in this particular vaccine, sometimes the boost can be prime and boost, like a mini traditional
okay.
vaccine where we do first one, second one, third, and the booster 1 year after.
Okay.
So for COVID is first prime and then boost about 3 to 6 weeks after.
Okay.
So
yeah,
the
yeah.
boost, as the name suggests, will enhance the initial immune reaction, which
okay.
was observed after the first shot. The boost will trigger much higher quantity of antibodies
mm-hmm.
ready to fight the infection. And what is very important, the ability to keep the memory of the virus will be also enhanced.
Okay.
So the cell will keep now the blueprint of this virus stored somewhere for a long time. And if another infection happen next 1, 2, 3, or sometimes even longer than that,
okay.
there will be the memory of the blueprint of this virus.
And all prime and boost, it's for all vaccines or it's specific? Like, for example, for Janssen, we know we have just one dose. How it works?
That's a good question. Some vaccination are just one single shot. If I'm correct, the yellow fever vaccination is just one single shot and then you do a booster a long time after.
Mm-hmm.
But it's true, in this whole range of vaccines which we have for COVID, one is a bit different, it's Janssen, from Johnson & Johnson Company.
Mm-hmm.
It's a mono-dose vaccine,
yes.
just a single injection. But there are some controversies of this because people believe that the duration of immunity is quite short. We'll come back to that later.
Yes.
Okay. So traditionally, when we do a vaccine, we start with the first one and second being the same vaccine, AstraZeneca, then 1 month later, AstraZeneca, Sinovac, and then Sinovac.
Mm-hmm.
That is called prime, boost, homologous. It's a bit technical term, homologous means the same.
Yeah.
Okay. Now, but this time, we had a kind of new type of prime boost being implemented.
Okay.
And we have seen that the second shot is different from the first one. For instance, person start with Sinovac and then the second is AstraZeneca. Okay. And that is called prime boost heterologous. Heterologous
okay.
for.
So it's a combination of two different vaccines, right?
Exactly. Yeah. Exactly. So you can have also sometimes AstraZeneca and then an RNA messenger vaccine. It happened also like this. Okay. Mm-hmm. So now when we look at the history of this, it seems that it was mainly triggered by some issues in terms of availability of vaccine or procurement. Mm-hmm. And it happened in Canada. In Canada, they started to vaccinate a large number of people with one vaccine they had. Mm-hmm. And they tried to vaccinate as many people as possible. And then they ran out of vaccine for the second.
Yeah, for the boost. I saw that, yes.
So what they did, okay, what do we have in hands? And they had another vaccine. They couldn't wait 6 months because, of course, the first one will be obsolete now.
Yeah.
So they start with the second boost
with another. Vaccine. Okay.
And I think, if I'm not mistaken, they use Astra first and then RNA messenger vaccine later on. Mm-hmm. And they said it should be no problem, not so much a problem, should be, because these two, Astra and RNA messenger vaccine, act on the spike protein, which is the main antigen. Mm-hmm. The focus on the production of antibodies. Okay. Later on, it seems that studies have confirmed that there is some kind of slight boost of immunity when you mixed different vaccines.
Yes.
But there is a concern about having also the side effects of the first and the second one at the same time. Mm-hmm. So it's not very clear whether this should be a strategy for the future.
I can imagine.
It has been used. So far, it seems that some governments still promoting this.
Okay.
Maybe some other studies will confirm that it's a relevant approach. Probably, I hope. But since we, as you know, we started the vaccination, the earliest was late December in the US. Mm-hmm. But actually, in Thailand, it was February. So we don't have 1 year experience so far.
Yeah. So the study is
exactly, and so without a clear-cut experience, we don't know whether this strategy is good, especially in terms of safety profile. Mm-hmm. Efficacy-wise, it seems to be okay. Let's see the safety a bit later.
Okay, thank you very much for the prime and boost. Another questions I just asked you before: could you tell us more about the third dose of COVID-19 vaccine? Because we hear, like, for example, the Sinovac, right? They have to do a third one 1 year later.
Yeah. Actually, it started also in Israel. Israel, as you know, is one of the most
advanced
in this aspect, one of the highest vaccination coverage in the world. And despite this, Israel began to face a new outbreak late June, July, due to the Delta variant. Mm-hmm. And despite the high coverage, they had to 10 or even 20,000 people being affected. So at that time, they realized that the duration of immunity induced by the vaccine was quite short. Mm-hmm. And they said that the only way is to do a booster.
Yeah.
This time is a booster to generate a bit more antibodies because it was already going down. So quickly. And on top of that, the issue was the fact that there was a different variant. This initial vaccine were done on the original Wuhan strain. And they realized also that the efficacy was decreasing also. Independently from the duration mm-hmm. of immunity induced by the vaccine, the efficacy was also going down. Initially, we are told that, for example, Moderna were above 90%, mm-hmm. 95%.
Yes.
And then recently in Israel, it was below 40 for Pfizer. So below 40 is actually below the threshold of WHO to qualify for effective vaccine against COVID-19.
Okay, so it can be a new trend, right?
Yes.
It can be.
Yes. So what they try to do is to induce additional booster, to try to boost the immunity. Whether the strategy is good or not, I'm not too sure what type of updated vaccine was done recently in July, because if it is the same as the original one in Wuhan, I don't think it will also be a very long efficacy in terms of immunity. Mm-hmm. We'll see.
What is the breakthrough infection? I note down this. Could you please explain?
Breakthrough infection is someone who has been fully vaccinated.
Like me?
Like you.
Yes.
And the next couple of days or couple of weeks, you get a COVID. Okay. This is a breakthrough infection after being fully vaccinated.
Okay.
And we, in Israel, most of the cases we had, because 70 plus 80% of the eligible population was already vaccinated.
Yes.
So most of the COVID cases were the breakthrough cases, actually. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Can you give us some numbers about the RNA vaccine? I mean, for over 90% with the original Wuhan virus, all these kind of numbers?
What do you mean, in terms of efficacy of the RNA?
Yeah, the person, yeah, efficacy, yes.
Percentage-wise, they look at the studies they've done in the US in mm-hmm. the middle of 2020. At that time, again, you have to consider what kind of strength mm-hmm. was present. It was the Wuhan, so they did the vaccine on the Wuhan strength.
Yes.
And the efficacy during these clinical trials in experimental conditions was about 95%. I said experimental condition because when you do a clinical trial, you make sure that you closely follow up every single case. Meaning to say, it's difficult to find in the general population, in the real world, mm-hmm. the exact type of result.
Yes.
But it seems that in Israel, there were also studies showing, confirming that in the initial phase of the vaccination, when they started to vaccinate very aggressively, starting from January, February, somewhere in April, May, before the Delta came, they were saying, there was a study published that, saying that the efficacy in the real world was close to what they discovered during the clinical trial, about 95%.
Mm-hmm.
However, that is worth to mention, all these people who published this trial were relatively closely related to Pfizer. So normally when there is a link or conflict of interest, we are a bit careful about looking at the result. But anyway, okay. That was the publication.
Just for your microphone, if you can just put it again. Sorry.
Sorry. It happens
on
live.
Yeah. So let's go for the next question during Doctor, just put the microphone on. So what about the new vaccines? Are they better? What is your actual think about it?
About the new vaccine?
Yes.
So first...
Maybe I can help you.
Yeah, please.
Yes. Okay, good.
Okay. First, the... pharma companies have realized that the duration of immunity is not great,
mm-hmm.
While the natural infection seems to confer a much longer mm-hmm. and robust immunity. But that is normal. I mean, a vaccine cannot be the natural infection because in a natural infection, the body has the whole virus.
Mm-hmm.
While doing this type of vaccine, they just got one piece of the blueprint of the virus. That is not surprising. So first, I think they will update their vaccine.
Mm-hmm.
They will keep the same technology, and then they will go again on the lab and select the type of new spike protein, which has been entering some mutation,
mm-hmm.
to develop now a new type of vaccine, which will trigger an immune reaction to this type of mutated spike protein. So that will be updated. That will come. As you know, there is the Delta variant, but there is another one called Mu, or Mu, I don't know, which is now seemingly a variant of concern from WHO. And they are probably also looking at this to prepare the updated vaccine.
Mm-hmm.
What can happen also, what they did in the dengue vaccine, for instance, as you know, dengue virus have four strains,
mm-hmm.
dengue 1, 2, 3, 4. And what Sanofi tried to do is to put a bit of these four in the same vaccine to be able to protect whatever the type of dengue type you are going to be infected with.
Okay.
So probably they will increase the number of significant variants in the future vaccine. Now, there are also new technological platform which will be used. I think maybe I can talk about Sanofi because it's French anyway, so maybe it's worth to mention that. And Sanofi is trying with the Sanofi had a difficult start,
mm-hmm.
which is fine. I mean, this kind of field is difficult to be right immediately.
Yes.
So maybe they were right to be slow or have difficulties. But now there seems to be pushing a lot about this new vaccine, which is using a recombinant protein type of vaccine. I will explain a little bit later if you ask me.
Yes.
Which they believe will be a kind of ideal booster, whatever the previous scheme, whether you get Sinovac, Sinovac, Astra, RNA vaccine, this one will be ideal third or fourth, maybe, for 2022 booster for COVID. Okay. And probably in the future, we'll see also combination.
Yes, you mentioned before.
Of COVID with flu. Mm-hmm. Because flu did not disappear. We're going to talk about it. That's another story. But I heard that some companies are mixing these two viruses to protect both COVID and influenza.
Okay, perfect. So this is the kind of new vaccine. Mm-hmm. Are they better than the previous one? It's also one of the questions people can ask.
When you say better, you have to look at several aspects. They can be better or worse, depending on the initial reaction and how much antibodies they protect. Mm-hmm. They will generate and protecting antibody, which we call neutralizing antibodies. Two, they will be also good or worse, or better or worse, in terms of duration of immunity. Okay. And the third, which is very important, whether they will be good for future variants. That's why some researchers believe, scientists believe, that when you use the whole virus, you get the whole blueprint that mm-hmm. was Sinovac, Sinopharm. That's the choice of the Chinese manufacturers. But to do that, you need a very specific lab ability. You need a what you call P4, at least, or P3, I think, type of laboratory to make sure that you don't let these bugs going out of the mm-hmm. laboratory. Okay. But in a way, the initial results seems to show that Sinovac, Sinopharm were not dramatically effective as compared with RNA vaccine. Mm-hmm. When I say not dramatically, they were about around 60 to 75% or 60 to 65%. Okay. So that in the general public, people believe that these are less effective than the RNA, which claim 95% efficacy through the clinical trials. But now when the variants came, we see that in Israel, it doesn't work anymore. It went down to 40. Now, Sinovac and Sinopharm may also decrease the efficacy, but not such a drop because, again, the immune system had the chance to look at the whole blueprint of the virus and be able to develop also antibodies, not only on the spike, but also other parts mm-hmm. of the virus. So this whole virus vaccine, attenuated virus vaccine, may have also an advantage in the long term. Maybe not as strong at the beginning, but in the long term, despite arrival of variant, they will still producing some kind of good efficacy in the long term.
Okay.
And you say also the last point for better. Mm-hmm. Better, you have to look also at the safety profile.
Yeah.
Now, safety profile, the traditional technological platform with attenuated whole virus, has been done for 17 years. Okay. So there could still be some side effects we are going to talk later, but more or less we know what could happen. So I jump now to the latest technology, which is RNA messenger vaccine. Here we still have a very limited experience.
Yes. Okay?
And we have to admit that. And when we make assertion, when we assert that these vaccines are totally safe, I think medicine, usually we are more prudent than that because we don't have enough experience, especially after 2 to 3 years. And we'll say why it's so important to wait 2 to 3 years. Okay. That's it.
Okay.
Yeah.
So the next question, thank you very much for this one. The next question will be, could you please give us some safety evaluation about the vaccine? Briefly. What you can recommend, also what you can give us about the safety evaluation.
Okay, if you don't mind, I will go back because mm-hmm. I think the people will be interested to know about this new platform which we are talking about. I heard that people are saying Sanofi or Novavax will be mm-hmm. really a fantastic vaccine. Of course, there's already some publicity going on and marketing being done. So I try to explain this. It's a bit technical, but let's see if people can follow this. So this is called recombinant protein COVID vaccine type of vaccination. Okay. So this is not totally new because, for instance, Sanofi is using this for flu vaccine already.
Okay.
So they master the technology in a way. They know how to do it, but of course it's a very, very sophisticated technology. Okay. So what they do in the lab, they copy the DNA sequence, which code for the spike protein. Okay. So make a DNA sequence, which when you put in the cell, it will code for the spike protein. Okay, so they have to insert this small part of DNA into a bigger DNA structure, which is called plasmid. And because you put a small part of DNA coding for the spike in a whole circle of DNA, we call it recombinant DNA. We have combined two parts of DNA.
Okay.
So this type of circle of DNA will be inserted into the genome of one virus, which is totally not injected into the body. It's a baculovirus, and this baculovirus will get the information on their genome to produce the spike protein.
Okay.
They have manipulated the genome of this virus. Now, this virus, which has the ability to create spike protein, they put in culture cell, not in the body.
Okay.
That is different from the AstraZeneca, Janssen, and RNA vaccine.
Yeah.
This is done in the lab. Okay.
Okay.
So in the lab, they put this virus, which has the ability to produce spike protein, So they put in a cell, and inside the cell they multiply, and make a big quantity of protein.
Okay.
Spike protein. After the preparation, they just collect all of these, they purify, and they have a pure concentrated of spike protein from this genetic manipulation.
Okay, and then?
And then they put in a syringe.
Okay.
And they put an adjuvant. Adjuvant, I don't know exactly what they use. An adjuvant is some kind of specific substance which also boosts the immunity to react against the spike protein, make it stronger in terms of immune reaction.
Okay.
Because the main difference is when you look at RNA vaccine, the code is inside a nanoparticle of lipid, which is injected, goes to the cell, our cell, and our cell produced the spike protein on which the immune reaction will come. Here the spike protein is already done outside, and we receive as injection only the spike protein.
Okay.
And then the body will look at this.
So we help, we help the body to understand more.
In a way.
Yeah.
Okay. So we ask the body just to focus on one thing, which is not producing spike protein, but just producing antibodies against this spike protein.
Okay. I see.
So
okay.
I hope it's not too technical.
It's a bit, but I found it, so it's fine.
Okay. So the next question was about the
safety. The safety evaluation about the vaccine. Yes.
Okay. So that is a very important question. So so far it seems that we have a relatively reassuring feedback, even though we have a lot of side effects that kind of denied in the short term. Although the severe allergic reactions I heard is not so many so far, but medium term or short term post acute injection. Like thrombosis, we have quite a lot, but it seems to be less than what COVID-19 induced itself. And we have also the reaction which we identify among the young male from 15 years old up to 30 years old, which is called myocarditis. Inflammation of the heart, or pericarditis, which is inflammation around the membrane around the heart. So my concern here, we don't have clear-cut explanation about how this happened. It seems to be a kind of autoimmune mechanism. Okay, fine, it can be autoimmune mechanism. And a reassuring message from one cardiologist I was listening to was, it's okay. I mean, the symptoms are resolved spontaneously, mm-hmm. no problem. So after a few days, even with minor treatment, it's over. But somebody would get autoimmune disease, even if it's on the short term, is still a concern for me,
yes.
because we don't know if we can return to that. So one thing which, in terms of safety, which we have really no clue so far, mm-hmm. is the long-term
yes.
side effects. And among the long-term, what is very well known among people who produce vaccine, and is a bit of nightmare for them, is what we call the antibody-dependent enhancement.
The ADE, right?
ADE. There are other terminology sometimes used.
Okay.
So this means ADE is negative, mm-hmm. deleterious reaction of the body due to the antibodies which has been created either by the disease itself or by the vaccine.
Okay. Okay.
So instead, to make it simple, normally antibodies are supposed to destroy the virus, but this time, when they destroy the virus, it's good, are called neutralizing antibodies.
Mm-hmm.
But this time, they are called facilitating antibodies. They take the virus, instead of killing it, they bring to the host cells and let the virus infect the cells.
Okay.
That's a nightmare.
Yeah, of course.
Okay. So this happened with the dengue vaccine, mm-hmm. very well, and also other diseases. And that has induced failed trials and also a big, big concern of using the dengue vaccine because of this. What is very important to understand here is this phenomenon does not happen immediately after injection. This phenomenon actually can happen also with the disease itself, meaning to say the people who have got a disease one time,
mm-hmm.
like dengue, the second disease, the second dengue they will get will be even more severe. You heard about it.
Mm-hmm. Yes, yes, yes.
It's the same for the people who receive the first vaccine,
mm-hmm.
then the long-term effect of this, because of this ADE, when the people will be infected, they will get a more severe COVID than if they do not get vaccinated. And mm-hmm. we have seen that with the dengue vaccine. But what is very important? During the first 2 years, everything was fine. You can see the two curves between the vaccinated and non-vaccinated. The vaccinated people had much less severe dengue than those who were not vaccinated.
Mm-hmm.
Okay? And then up to the late second year, close to the third year, then the curve cross. Meaning
yes.
to say, those who were vaccinated get a more severe dengue than those who were not vaccinated.
Yeah.
Okay? And that happened in the third year. In fact, during the first 2 years, the regulator said, that's fine, we give you the official registration.
Mm-hmm.
You can sell your product. But there was something strange already happening, and the regulators, the WHO and so on, said, you have to prolong the studies. Let's see what is going on. And at that time, we saw after the third year, it crossed.
Boom, yeah.
Okay. So the very big concern we can have here is most of the studies will not go beyond these 3 years.
Mm-hmm.
So
for the moment, yes.
No, because the pharma will not continue.
Will not continue this
no.
study.
No. So they no one ADA exists. Government knows. But pharma said we cannot do this forever. So take over. So it should be the government, the Ministry of Health, to put in place all the pharmacovigilance, the monitoring of side effects to make sure that not ADA will come.
Okay.
The big pharma are not saying they wash their hands, but that will not be their concern anymore.
Mm-hmm.
So this is a serious concern for many scientists who believe that we even talk about this. Of course, we talk about this, we will be part of the anti-vax group. We are not anti-vax, I'm vaccinated myself also. But we need to be aware about what can possibly happen. I'm not saying it will happen, but it could happen. Okay.
Okay. Thank you very much for the safety information. So we got some key message each time. The part one, it was about the 72 hours. The
yeah.
second part, the long COVID, was about the social distancing and also the vaccination.
Yeah.
What about our third key take-home message? today.
Okay. It's good we finish again in 30 minutes or 34 minutes. I think it's good to keep this time.
Yes. Since
the topic was long and a bit, in a way, complicated, as you put here, there are 4 points, not only one single take-home message. Okay. So vaccine efficacy, I think the anti-COVID-19 vaccine are beneficial without any doubt for those who are at risk of getting either the disease or a severe form of the disease.
Mm-hmm.
So I think people above 55, 60 years old, there is a good rationale to get this vaccine, and those who have also risk to develop a severe form, we know the comorbidities,
yes,
diabetes, etc. Okay. So no doubt about it. That's the first things here. And I think most of the people, even those who have strong concern about side effects with vaccine in the long term, do agree that for these high-risk people, we have seen at this age, about 65, 70, 80, you see a percentage of people dying from COVID or going to ICU quite significant. So it's logical that we try this means of protecting them by vaccine.
Mm-hmm.
The second point you put here is vaccine strategy. So here, whether we go on prime, boost, homo, or heterologous, that I'm not too sure. Probably from what I see, the trends, even in the Thai government, there seems to put an emphasis on heterologous prime boost, with, for instance, Sinovac and then Astra. It seems that it produces a stronger production of antibodies. So
mm-hmm.
let's do for that. But we still keep a very close eye about the side effects, because there can be a combination of two side effects from this vaccine.
Yeah.
Here we don't have enough, let's say, experience again. Okay. Because, as you know, some of these vaccines are still on the experimental phase,
mm-hmm.
since they don't have the official registration. So
yeah.
We are doing some experimentation on an ongoing experimentation. So it's
yeah.
a bit funny in a way. vaccine safety here. Okay. Short term is starting to be better known. We still have concern, like what the children are suffering, even though the myocarditis is fine also in normal COVID.
Mm-hmm.
And some people are saying that actually the disease itself induces more myocarditis than the vaccine. But that's strange, because we never talk about myocarditis before we start to talk about it with a vaccine.
I see.
So now we look at the disease itself. We have also.
Yeah.
So it's a bit strange to me. But anyway, the point here I'd like to stress, because I already experienced that myself, the side effects are not always reported. Actually, probably a small percentage of side effects are not reported, and even though they are just a few days, few hours, few weeks after the vaccine, it doesn't mean that all these side effects are related or attributed to the vaccine. Of course, no. We know, especially when you vaccinate people above 75, 80 years old, these people, unfortunately, can still have a heart attack or a stroke
mm-hmm.
any time of their life, because they are already in a high peak of that. But we cannot just deny it. And I know by experience that when somebody considered old get a severe cardiovascular event, for instance,
mm-hmm.
this is his life. That's normal. No, it's not normal. If you get a vaccine a few days before, we still need to report. And maybe we'll see some signal on that. So unfortunately, this has been always an issue in epidemics, because there are not so much focus on that.
Mm-hmm.
The last point about safety is okay, as I said, for the short term. Okay, relatively. The long-term safety is not understood and cannot be understood now, because we don't have experience. We need to wait to see if ADE may happen after 2 to 3 years. And also, we have some concern about the short experience with totally new technology like
mm-hmm.
RNA vaccine, which has never been used before, including animals, very few trials in animals. But it might be a promising technology, so let's see.
Mm-hmm.
I would be very glad that it shows that it's very effective, not only in vaccine technology, but also in in treatment of cancer, because I know that there are many development done with this technology now.
And what about the vaccination about children?
This, I think, is the most controversial topic.
Yes.
Is debated. It seems that one of the key rationale to justify vaccination among kids is to focus on the fact that kids can also transmit the virus to someone. And there were a lot of discussion about the kids which can infect their grandfather. Meaning to say the kids may induce the disease to the grandfather, who could die from the disease. Okay. Very dramatic things. So vaccinated children will be not really for him, because the risk for kids seems to be one case for 1 million. One child will die from COVID for 1 million. So you see that the risk is so little. So we have to expect a totally very high benefit to justify this so minimal risk. So what they do to justify this is to say that the vaccination is for the sake of the collective impact.
Okay.
So the kids are vaccinated not to protect them, really, but more to make sure that it will not disseminate the virus and protect the rest of the community.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. That is new, because in the past, vaccination is something which you do for yourself.
Yes.
To protect yourself.
Mm-hmm.
If I vaccinate myself, it's not to protect you. To protect me.
Yourself,
okay?
Yes.
So, it's a delicate topic. I know that in many countries, they start vaccinating people 12 years old and above. It seems that even in the US, they are considering to go even lower.
Yes, babies as well.
I even heard that they may start from 6 months old. So this is... it is a debate.
Yes, that's true.
Let's conclude like this.
Yeah, we can conclude like this. I think it's a good idea. So I really would like to thank you, Doctor, for all these researches and also for these three parts of the Luma Life series. I really appreciate it to interview you about all the information about the vaccines, but all about COVID-19 in Thailand and globally. So yes, so do not hesitate to follow us on Facebook, LinkedIn, Instagram, and Line. And of course, we will be happy to welcome you for the next Facebook Live. Or even if you have any questions, do not hesitate to put on the comments line and also contact us with our phone numbers, emails, and also in our chat. Thank you very much, Gérard.
Welcome, most welcome.
And thank you for viewing us and be with us for these three parts of the Luma Life series. Thank you very much, and have a good day.
Thank you.